extent. We didn't want to say that it couldn't continue. We didn't want to say that it would continue forever. And the general consensus was that eventually it would be phased out. But I'm not sure how to put that in there.
Councilor McGinty?
I agree with what Councilor Groff said. I'd like to see this go through the appropriate process. As if anybody remembers, I asked that that process be followed for this meeting so we would have been reviewed. We could have acted on this after the Planning Board and the Fort Williams Advisory Commission had seen it. The consensus was that wouldn't happen. We didn't have enough time. But I agree with Councilman Groff that there are, you know, there are some question marks here, and some is just minor fine-tuning. But again, I agree. If we're going to do this, let's do it right. I 99% support what's in here, but I'd like to see us go through the process. And I said that before, and I still stand by that.
I will reiterate for Councilman McGinty that there was not enough time. This barely. Yeah,
that's fine.
I'm
not
right
disagreeing. There wasn't enough time, but let's give it the time now to get it done right. That's all.
Okay, Councilor Reed.
I'm just restating my concerns, and also I would strongly recommend that if there is a suggestion and a consensus of this group that that AAA field be phased out, that it be so stated. And I'm also concerned about a representation that the Fort Williams Advisory Commission has seen this. I happen to have been at the meeting when it was discussed. The chairman of the Fort William Advisory Commission is here, and I'd like to ask, has your commission as a whole seen this and discussed it in a meeting? Thank you very much.
The answer was no. Councilor O'Neill, did I see your hand?
Well, I was just going to say, I have a, if this fails a second, I have another motion.
It hasn't been seconded, so go ahead.
This has not been seconded?
I have another motion.
Excuse me, Councilor Jordan?
No, I just want to say I kind of deal with what's been said going around the table here. If the committee hasn't seen it, and I think it needs some fine-tuning. I think we should wait. I don't know. I just don't quite understand. Somebody explain to me why we got to do it tonight. Why do we have to do it tonight?
Well, I think I think part of the reason that we have to, that people want us to do it tonight is, and I understand the feeling, there hasn't been much trust between the groups, and this is a sign of trust that the people that were adamantly opposed to this field have come around and I think done a tremendous service to this town by working together with other groups and coming to a compromise, and this is the fruit of that compromise. And I really understand that people want to see that work product tonight and want it to be done and want it to be accepted. And in concept, you're there. I mean, there is an opposition in this council to this document. What we need to do, though, is make sure that the document says what we all want it to say. But the concept of setting aside that part of the park is consistent with the master plan. There was only ever one field on the master plan, and this goes a step further, and I can't imagine this council not reaching that consensus, but we have to do it the right way, and I think that's the reason that the big push tonight is it's a matter of trust and to make sure that we don't have acrimony again and we have some moving forward.
Councilor O'Neill.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. My motion would be, be it ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council acknowledges receipt of the report of the Fort Williams Park Working Group and refers to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board the report for comments.
Second.
All comments are to be received no later than December 15, 1996.
Second.
With that time frame, the council would next visit this no earlier than January 1997?
I'd like to see it moved up. I'd like to see us get it done as quickly as the commission and the planning board can do it.
We do not have a representative here this evening from the planning board. I'm not aware of the project review load for that group. Do you have any?
They're their agenda for this month is very, very light, but it's already been published, and usually they don't add anything after the fact. Their workshop agenda is...
It's bad, sorry.
Yeah, very heavy.
Very heavy.
Even if we move it up just a month to November...
The reason I chose the December 15th date was recognizing that generally you don't like to have these major decisions made in December, because there's so much else going on, and people complain about that. January just seemed like a better time for it to return to the council.
Counselor McGinty.
Well, I think we got to get this done. I agree, again, with Counselor Groff, I guess we're agreeing a lot, that there is an issue here of trust between the citizens and the council. We need to get this done. I don't think it's going to be a major decision-making process. We've all said we're looking at maybe some fine-tuning, some words here, just some clarifications in some cases. And I think we need to get it done. And I'm willing to, if you consider this a heavy decision, I'm really willing to make it in December.
Thank you. Would the motioner consider revising the motion that comments will be received no later than, what, 30 days, that's September, November 30th? That would get potentially waived.
You really want it a little bit earlier than that, so the council has a chance to get it prior to the meeting, if you want to have a workshop on the comments, if you really want to get it moving.
Mm-hmm.
You don't, you know, that's one of the problems with this thing. It came in a week and a half after the council...
This was...
You know, everything else was in, and about a week after.
Mm-hmm. If it were received back, comments were received back by mid-November...
November 20th.
November 20th, council would need a workshop before its December meeting, or...
Just leave open the option of having...
Or receive it back in December and workshop, and then deal with it in January. There is a time frame, while we're mulling over some of that, and I can see the wheels turning, Councilor McGinty, I think the council is well-served in following its normal procedures on process. We have been well-served in the past. We have been taken to task by people who have accused us of not following process. I don't want that accusation to come back on this council, and I would rather be accused in this instance of too much process. The council has not had time to thoroughly review this. It was a lot of very hard effort, a lot of very dedicated work by these eight people. I mean, when I received this, I instantly started editing. There were things that weren't quite the way I thought they should be, and sometimes just a couple of words changed in some people's mind changes the intent. It needs to be clarified sometimes. And if we're going to do this, I would like to see us do it properly, take the time we need to take to have a very good product. I'm not going to take comments from the audience at this point. I'm going to leave it at the council discussion. But I don't know. I also very much respect the desire for this to come back to us as quickly as possible. If we could ask Mr. Van Fleet, what does your load of agenda items look like?
It should be on the agenda for the 19th this month, if that's your wish.
Thank you. Planning board. Planning board could deal with it in October, presumably.
The 1st of November, for sure.
I do not have a feel for the planning board workload. Councilor O'Neill?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're all pretty good for our word. I hope we are. I think due process would serve us well. I don't think, you know, I don't think anything going anywhere. I'm concerned. If we had done this tonight, we would have made at least one, I think, very serious mistake. And I don't want to make another one.
Okay.
So I just soon
Are you changing the date or sticking the 15th?
I'd like to stick with my motion. And
okay. the potential timeframe could be a council, does anybody have a calendar?
John does.
What do you need?
Have January in it?
Yep.
Council meeting in January is on the, whoops, that's February. I tried. Oh, good, it's late. We could have a council workshop on this the week before the council meeting in January. Council meeting in January is on the 13th. Councilor Groff?
I think this is a huge mistake. We have to move forward quicker than that, because this is going to, until we get this approved, fundraising's going to be dead in the water. We're going to miss another year. This group that works so hard to tie these two things together deserves better than waiting till next year to hear a decision of this council. And it's just going to make the whole town, we're not going to be able to go forward in this project. The Fort Williams Commission said they can do it this month. This, to me, is a priority. The planning board can, I'm here till 12. I mean, they can fit this in somehow. We can all get it. We can do our work, and we can move this. And to, the idea of waiting to January, to me, on this proposal is ludicrous, because this is a good proposal with a lot of hard work, and it's not going to be that much effort to be able to get this in a position where we're all going to be happy.
I believe that the planning board needs to have a public hearing on this, because it is a proposed ordinance change. Is that correct?
It's an amendment to the zoning ordinance it would need.
Okay.
Well, are we actually, we're not making that recommendation for an ordinance change. We're just, the paper says that that's what we should do.
Mm-hmm.
But are we actually making?
That's how you implement it.
That is part of the implementation proposal for this. It goes hand in hand with the policy creation. If you can create a policy and then
well, but this talks about the Zork draft.
Mm. It's referenced
to the Zork process.
Mm. Yep. Good point. Councilor Cogsell?
This, the present ordinance for the Fort Williams Park is not drafted quite the same way when it deals with all the uses, mm-hmm. but the new proposal from the Zork committee does sort of restructure the Fort Williams District Park District ordinance, and this could go into feedback from both of these groups, and it could be incorporated into the final approval of the Zork draft. We didn't deal with the current ordinance because it just didn't fit. There was no way of really tinkering with the current ordinance. We could double check with the planner and see, you know, or you could work
if it
on
needs
that,
to fit in the current ordinance, it can be made to fit, and that's
right.
Another thing we
it
need to
easier.
Hear from the planning board and planning staff. You know, there wasn't time once this was developed to get it to them to know the better way to deal with it.
I move the question.
Okay. The motion.
What is the date?
Is to acknowledge receipt, to refer it to Fort Williams Advisory Commission and the Planning Board with comments received back no later than December 15.
So it gets us into January. Still January.
All those in favor?
That's just the receipt of this document.
Receipt, referring it to Fort Williams Commission and to the Planning Board, then asking for them to get comments back to us by December 15.
And just so I understand, the consensus is that is the absolute quickest we can move?
Right.
And there's nothing we can do quicker than that? Is that what you're telling me? Is it?
I'm trying to.
We can certainly give the message to both of those boards that the council is extremely eager to get this, and that October 15th would be much preferred over December 15th.
Then why don't
we just do that?
Let's make the motion that way.
Yeah, and we can always let it, you know, if there's good reason, I can sit here and say, okay, you didn't make it, but I don't want to give people, if you give people that much time, they use all that time. I mean, let's
Fine.
Are you amending?
Yes, amend.
To what? October 15th?
No. October 16th.
October 16th.
October 16th. Forget about that tailgate party.
October 16th, which is the next council meeting.
I'm ready.
All those...
Is this the next council meeting?
Yes. That's the date of the next council meeting.
That's when the comments will be due back.
That's right.
Yes, sir. Okay. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 77 and 78 refer to a proposed charter amendment which would put to referendum in November a potential change of when the municipal election is held. It is currently held in May. Proposed change would be to have the municipal election held in November, starting with November of 1997. I'm catching the 20-year regression here. This is a public hearing. Is there anybody in the public who would like to speak to this issue? Again, it is whether or not we will put it on the referendum, to a referendum in November. It is not whether or not the council wants you to vote one way or the other. Yes, ma'am.
This is a public hearing, right?
This is a public hearing.
I think it would be a mistake to change the local election to November. Local election issues and candidates will have a lot of trouble competing for the voters' attention in November. I would like to suggest that instead of putting November to the voters, that you put June as a possibility. We already go to vote June on at least some years, but that would at least allow for local issues to get a little bit more attention. I don't think the goal is for us to have maximum voters, but we need informed voters. And I think that local issues are, I think they're the most important. Unfortunately, the vote is just reversed. We go the most often to vote in presidential elections where that has the least amount of effect on our lives. We vote the least for local elections where it has the most effect on our lives. So don't try and bury local elections among all the rest. At least, I mean, I don't have any problem with May, but at least don't put it in November. At least put it in June. That's the date that Falmouth and Cumberland and Yarmouth, I think, have it. So thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Marvin Chaikin, 87 Ocean House Road. I want to speak in favor of the item 77 from both the voters' perspective as well as from the Board of Voter Registration and the election process itself. I think it's highly desirable to affect the economy of consolidating into one major day voting on issues affecting town, county, state, national, as appropriate. And so I think it's an economy which the town can afford to take, and I think the results will be better voting, more people coming out to vote. They will vote for the issues that are brought to their attention. If the issues are relevant, they'll make their vote known. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You sick of the Chapman family yet?
Not yet.
Ann Chapman, 77 Hillcrest Road. And actually, I'm here really as a school board member, and I'm not presuming to speak for other school board members, but frankly, I think the election in May works really well for the school board, because having new school board members come on in June, you have the whole summer to get acclimated, to go through orientations. It's extraordinarily important, the complexity of the issues we're dealing with, and, you know, the relative inexperience of the people usually coming to those positions, I think make that time very important. And having people come on in December, when we're already involved in our budget process, we're generally negotiating with all our bargaining units. We have, what, five? And all those issues just would make it very difficult, I think, for the school board members. I understand why it would be more convenient for the voters to only go one day, but frankly, I agree that the local issues might get lost in November also, but really, if you're going to get the best out of your school board members, I think it's great that they have that summer to get acclimated, and I don't think the cost is so high of doing this. I think Debbie said it was $1,200 to $1,500, that it's worth changing it, because I don't think you'll get as effective service out of people on their first year. And just on a personal, only slightly joking note, I would say that for those of us who are currently serving, extending our term 6 months kind of feels like involuntary servitude. So.
Thank you, Mrs. Chia. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak to this? Okay, thank you. Can we have a motion, please? Council McGinty.
Yes, I'll make it. Be it ordered, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby submit to the voters of the town of Cape Elizabeth to be voted upon on November 5th, 1996, the following proposed amendment to the council manager charter of the town of Cape Elizabeth. Revise Article 7, Section 1 to read, Section 1, Municipal Elections. In the year 1997, the regular election for members of the town council and school board shall be held on the Tuesday following the first Monday in November. All elections shall be conducted on a nonpartisan basis and without party designations on the election ballot. The terms of those town councilors and school board members in office, which would otherwise expire on June 9, 1997, shall be extended to expire on the second Monday of December 1997. Terms of those town councilors and and school board members in office which would otherwise expire on the second Monday of June 1998 or the second Monday of June 1999 shall expire on the second Monday of December of 1998 and 1999 respectively. Revise Article 2, Section 5 to read, Section 5, Induction of the Council into Office. The Town Council shall meet at the usual place for holding meetings on the second Monday in December following the regular municipal election. Beginning in 1997, at said meeting, councilors-elect shall be sworn to the faithful discharge of their duties by the town clerk or by a notary public and a record made thereof. Revise Article 4, Section 3 to read, Section 3, Department of Education, Organization, and Quorum. The members of the school board shall meet for organization on the second Monday in December following the regular municipal election. Beginning in 1997, at said organizational meeting, school board members elect shall be sworn to the faithful discharge of their duties by the town clerk or by a notary public and the record made thereof. The majority of the whole number of the school board shall be a quorum.
Thank you. Do we have a second? Thank you. John was getting worried.
I'd like to make it clear that, you know, we're not voting to change this. All we're voting is to put this on the ballot so that the citizens of the town of Cape Elizabeth can decide for whatever purpose and whatever reason whether they want to change this. And so the sole purpose tonight is to place this on the ballot and let the people decide.
Correct. Thank you. Councilor Linnell.
I think I'm going to defer to the wishes that coming from a member of the school board. I think the issues are better hammered out with a separate election. I think the school board concerns are real, and it's pretty rare that we get a lot of participation from the public except at election time. And so I guess I don't think I'll support it.
Thank you. Councilor Cogsell?
Oh, I was looking at Rosemary.
Yeah, I don't always look at you, and
I don't feel there really is enough demand to set this municipal elections to November. I feel that a lot of careful thought and deliberation was put into choosing May, not just because other towns were having it at that time. I think we get a better airing of our issues. We have a completely separate election. And thanks to School Board Member Chapman's comments, I wasn't aware of the real need for this extra time to help orient your new members. That was very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Reed?
Well, being a former member of the school board, I was probably the one that the school board members call first, but four members of the school board will not serve the extra 6 months and do not want the election moved. So although Ann, as the former chairman, got to speak tonight because of her perseverance, she is not alone in her concerns.
Councilor Jordan?
So you're telling me they would resign? They would resign, huh?
Instead of serving 3.5 years?
Excuse me.
I just want to say that I feel this is something that you're putting before the people and let the people decide and see how they feel about it. And this is all we're asking tonight, put it before the people. I am not concerned about using the identity as I was years ago. And with the counting deal years ago, when you done it by hand, one by one ballot, that it made a time-consuming deal. With the computers today, I think you've got to look in that direction. So I'm going to vote in favor of putting this before the people.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor Reed?
I just want to reiterate the cost at $1,200 to $1,500 may be far less than the cost of a mistake by an ill-informed or a not well-informed school board member. I won't make it a town councilor by my example.
Thank you. Anybody else? I concur with the comments that have made in supporting keeping the council elections as they are in May, and my vote will reflect that. All those in favor of the motion? The motion is to put this on a referendum this November to change the election date to November. All those in favor? All those opposed? Vote is 3-4, fails. Get all the opposed. Okay. That makes item number 78 moot, I believe.
Table it indefinitely.
Tabled to
so moved.
Tabled indefinitely.
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. I would like at this time to move that we take item number 80 out of order.
So moved.
Thank you. Do I have a second on taking item number 80, our last public hearing, out of order?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 80 is a public hearing and subsequent vote on the proposed purchase of a lot next to the Thomas Memorial Library for the amount of $35,900. I believe we have some public who would like to address this evening. Introduce yourself, please.
My name is Kevin King. I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth, and I represent the Hennessy Estate.
The Hennessy Estate has entered into a contract to sell a small parcel of real estate to the town of Cape Elizabeth. What I'd like to do today is just address the council here and kind of give you a little bit of a background on this and a little bit of history, and then maybe withdraw, allow the public to make comments, and then maybe do a closing afterwards. On May 20th, we entered into an agreement with the town of Cape Elizabeth to sell this lot to the town. From a prior real estate sale, one of the abutters had a first right of refusal to purchase the property. Tim Thompson was that abutter, and he executed his first right of refusal to purchase the property. He had 77 days to close on the property through August 8th. In the history of this process, on several occasions, I wrote Mr. Thompson letters, sent him certified mail, reminding him of his time for closing, reminding him that the town of Cape Elizabeth had left their contract in place subject to him not closing by his deadline. On July 19th, I sent him a certified letter 50 days before the closing, stating that if he didn't purchase the property by August 8th, that it would be sold to the town on August 9th. On July 12th, I sent him a letter asking for the name he'd like the deed in because he was going to close before August 9th. In a phone conversation subsequent to that, I suggested that he close prior to August 9th if he really wanted to purchase the real estate. On July 31st, after not hearing from Mr. Thompson, I sent a letter signing a closing date in an attorney's office and telling him that we would prepare a deed in his name. Still didn't hear from him on an earlier closing date. On August 8th, 77 days after I notified him that the town had made an offer or was under contract on this piece of property, 1.5 hours before the closing, I got a message on my answering machine that Mr. Thompson had personal problems, and I can't address those personal problems, but he would not be at the closing. His attorney was not going to be at the closing. His banker was not going to be at the closing. He didn't have a single agent at the closing. He had been advised that he would require a certified check to be at the closing, so he certainly knew that, you know, he had to do that. To try to give my client some comfort level, the Hennessy Estate, I called his banker. His banker didn't know anything about the closing. So on that date, we waited all day for him. We went to the closing. I left a message on his machine that we'd be waiting for him at the closing. He didn't show. The town was notified that they could continue on with their contract to purchase the real estate. I heard from Mr. Thompson 6 days later on August 14th. He asked me to reconsider the closing at that point. I explained to him that we had an obligation to the town of Cape Elizabeth to sell to him. I also asked him if he was prepared to close that day or the following day. He was not. Since then, Mr. Thompson has made several claims about his rights on this property and that he still has the right to purchase this property. The Hennessy Estate would like to sell this property to the town of Cape Elizabeth for several reasons. When we entered into the agreement with the town of Cape Elizabeth, we took a lower offer than we originally had intended to take for the reason that it was to benefit the town. The Hennessys are residents of this town. I'm a resident of this town. There wasn't going to be a long period of delay because the town could close fairly quickly, and we didn't have any zoning requirements. In Mr. Thompson's original execution of his right of first refusal, he asked for zoning variances. He asked for us to finance it, then he asked for financing. And those were some of the things that we tried to avoid. We did give Mr. Thompson his full 77 days to close on this property. We reminded him consistently that he was willing to, that he had that obligation to close. He didn't do it. I'm sorry he didn't do it. As I said before, we'd like to sell this property to the town of Cape Elizabeth. I've been in contact with the town's attorney. The attorney for Stephen Whiting for the Hennessy Estate's been in touch with the town's attorney. We've got title insurance that we believe will be able to provide the town of Cape Elizabeth, which will protect the town and says that you have a clear title. If there's a requirement for us to indemnify any legal bills indemnify the town legally to sell this property to the town of Cape Elizabeth, we're willing to do that in the estate.
and we'd like to go forward now and do that. I'm sure that Mr. McGovern's talked to Tom Leahy, knows what Tom Leahy's concerns are, and we'd like you guys to make an amendment, or make a proposal to pass this for the town to purchase this property, subject to us giving the town's attorney a comfort level that the town will not suffer any cost or any risk in making this purchase. Rita may want to talk a little bit later. I think Tim Thompson wants to talk about this, and there may be some other questions. I'd like to reserve an opportunity to come back up here and talk to the town again. Okay? I did prepare a timeline. If I didn't know if it was appropriate to hand it out.
We can certainly receive that.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank
King.
You.
Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this item?
My name's Tim Thompson. I'm a resident in Cape Elizabeth as well, and I do own at 6 Pine Ridge Road. And I do own a business property across the street over here, 299 Ocean House Road. I purchased that property in 12 of 94, and at the time I received, as part of a settlement on some earlier disclosure issues, a right of first refusal in that back lot. And I had certain rights to exercise that purchase, which I exercised on May 29th, as was required by the purchase agreement. There was a fair amount of confusion surrounding the purchase agreement. It should have been a fairly simple exercise of first refusal. Mr. King, who was acting as the real estate broker in this situation, sent a purchase agreement along, which required a deposit, which they still have, which I had put in a request for a contingency to put a 2,000 square foot building up on two levels. In the disclosure information that had been sent to me by Mr. King indicated that he had preliminarily it was all diagrammed out where I could put a 4,000 or 3,000 square foot building up on each level. Obviously, in processing through that created some difficulties for me. But the bottom line is basically on the date that, and by the way, the closing date that had been set was May the 8th, which I was notified by fax on Sunday, the previous Sunday, which I didn't obviously get until that Monday, of the closing date and the location. But the reason that I missed that closing date was that my mother-in-law had congestive heart failure the night before, and I was in intensive care in Massachusetts. So I had requested that first thing that morning that a short delay to exercise my first right of refusal. He was notified immediately of that. I've subsequently communicated with Mr. King on numerous occasions requesting that we basically just set a date. For whatever reason, that has not taken place, and I was warned in writing by Mr. King to be careful what I said tonight, and obviously my lawyer has said just state the facts, that we exercised the first right of refusal. We've requested on numerous occasions to be able to exercise that right. I was warned not to talk with Mr. McGovern about this. Basically, I just wanted to share with him why I had missed that, and it was my intent to close, and I was simply asking whether or not the town would pursue litigation against the Hennessys if they did go ahead and sell the property to me. I was certainly assured that the town would not litigate against the Hennessys if they did pursue that with me. We currently are pursuing our rights. We would like to close on that. And that's basically just how I feel about the purchase, my obvious vested interest in purchasing this property. I would like to comment about the process. I had understood that the bona fide offer that had been tendered by the town had no contingencies whatsoever. Obviously, this is a contingency that has got to be gone through the public hearing process. Is there a bona fide offer in place? is a deposit, is this public hearing kind of after the fact? I feel very strongly that this is one of the last pieces of property in downtown, in the town center, where we do have an opportunity to do something and not take another piece of property off of the tax rolls. It may seem like a little bit of money, $36,000 for the purchase of this property. I've been told that the purpose of this is to purchase the property to build a additional parking for the town library. I'm not sure that any study has been done. Maybe there has been a study been done by the town that indicates we need additional parking. My office looks right out the window on this lot over to the town parking at the library, and it's rarely full. If it is full, it's typically full in the evening when people are over at the community room. Certainly, if I'm able to go forward and purchase this property and build a small building there, you can park as much as you want in the evenings in my parking lot. I do think there's strong reason to consider, and this again is just me talking as a town citizen, not as the abutter that wants to buy this piece of property, but I think we need more opportunities for business in downtown. I think it's an opportunity to have some office space as well as some retail space. It's certainly, from what I've been told, it's a piece of property that a small building is capable of going up, and that is certainly my intention. So I'd like you to, I don't know how many other people are going to have an opportunity. Certainly not, the abutters didn't get a written notice that this public hearing was taking place. I don't know how many people are interested in presenting their views on this, but certainly when we're talking about trying to save $1,200 or $1,500 by changing our election guidelines, and we're talking about trying to save money wherever we can to take another piece of property off the town tax rolls that could be bringing in $4,000 or $5,000 in tax dollars, and maybe even creating some local jobs, doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. So I'd ask that you reconsider that and maybe keep this property on the tax rolls. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this item? Does somebody let people who haven't had a turn yet? Thank you.
Jesus,
hello.
I'm home after this, and I hope you are shortly too.
Fix the microphone, please, Mrs. Chapman. Thank you.
Sorry, I know I'm not quite as tall. I had alluded in that memo I sent you on the other issues to this issue as well. First of all, I agree with Mr. Thompson that I don't think a lot of people are really aware that this is taking place. I saw a little blurb in the Cape Courier that was pretty easy to miss, I think, and people who I talked to just in the past few days were surprised to hear that this decision was going to be made tonight. But frankly, having just gone through the whole building process for the schools and spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on huge parking lots in very, very close proximity to the library, I just cannot see any reason for adding more parking right in the town center. I also agree that we might as well keep some of our property in the town center on the tax rolls. I just really don't see why we can't really implement the town, the one town concept in terms of parking. That parking's right there, particularly the small lot that's right off Scott Dyer is very, very easy access to the library. And again, I rarely see that lot full. There's always space in the school lots. And I would really implore you that if you've got $36,000 to spend, you spend it on more books in the library, or you put it towards some of these safety issues on the road. But I just really don't see this as a pressing need. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Chapman. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this? Mr. King?
Yeah. One last comment. First of all, the real estate contract that I provided, Mr. Thompson, was exactly the same as the town's. We didn't cash his check, and the reason that we dropped the real estate contract with him is because he added contingencies, and so we just sent him a letter stating that we just act under the first right of refusal. This property produces minimal taxes for the town because it's an empty lot, and until it's built on, I'm not sure that the town plans to put a parking lot there or anything else. The town plans to land bank the property, as I understood it. And as I said before, Mr. Thompson was afforded every opportunity to purchase his real estate and failed to do so. Did you want to say anything?
I'm Rita Hennessy, and I am the trustee of Hennessy Children's Trust, and I'm the agent for the sale of this property, which is in the Hennessy Children's Trust. I'm a little confused by, I've been always confused by this claim. The claim seems to be that I wasn't nice to Tim Thompson by allowing him an extension when he doesn't seem to be in contention with the fact that he missed his opportunity to buy this property. The problem seems to be that I wasn't nice enough to give him an extension. My response to that was I had a legal responsibility standing with the town of Cape Elizabeth on the day after his option was up. And now, to me, that legal situation takes precedent. I have had dealings with Tim in the past, and I have not been pleased with him. I do not care to do business with him. I care to do business with the town of Cape Elizabeth, with whom I have never had any problem. I think you've made a reasonable decision for the good of the people of the town of Cape Elizabeth, and I've made a reasonable decision for the good of my children, and I would like to proceed with this transaction which we have before us. If there are other issues, I'm happy to to answer any questions about them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Hennessy. Councilor McGinty? Oops, I'm sorry.
One thing I think is important, and I'm not going to make this a personal issue. I really don't have any problem at all dealing with Mrs. Hennessy and the trust. I'm not exactly sure what her problem is with me, but this property, when we went through the process of this being separated from the piece of property that I purchased on the date of the sale, we went back and forth and back and forth on what was the appraised value of this property, and never basically could end up with an agreement, and so I ended up paying more taxes than what any mathematical assumption would be able to come up with. But this property is, with that vigorous going back and forth, this property is tax appraised at $28,000. And, you know, the town is looking at spending some $36,000, certainly a premium by any standard. Quotes in the appraisal that I got at the time I purchased it, quoting the people in the town's employ, this was a relatively valueless lot with little potential for doing anything with it. And now we're considering, as a town, spending $36,000 for this piece of property. I think that it's reasonable to go back and from a town standpoint and wonder when money is as tight as it is and people are as concerned as they are about the taxes and what we're already spending on town on school improvements, community center. We've got a piece of property that is land banked or in inventory sitting next door to us in this ex gas station. Is this really something that's necessary at this time? But it is currently tax appraised at some $28,000.
Thank you. Councilor McGinty? Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Who's going to go?
Yeah, could we have the manager?
Yeah, I wanted to do a little introduction like would be typical on one of these issues. There's been some things said this evening that, you know, I think are difficult, particularly at this late hour. First of all, I'd like to address some of Mrs. Chapman's comments. The fact of it is the school is always putting pressure on our school library for parking spaces because the school doesn't like the fact, the school teachers, that there aren't enough parking spaces up that end of the Pond Cove School. And the parking lot she speaks of that is empty, I've never, you know, I even checked it every day, but it's usually quite well filled every day. The one between the Pond Cove Elementary School and the middle school. And it's also not that easy to get to from the Thomas Memorial Library. You have to go up the driveway, across the whole front of the Veterans Memorial, across the front of the library, and back into the library. It's, for someone going into a library for program of books, it's just not that accessible. Second, you know, I think we're forgetting the whole purpose. The library is in a squeezed corner there. They're not, the school department's not about to ever let us expand out onto the school playground, because playgrounds are already at a premium, playground space, extremely valued there. The only way we have to expand eventually is out to the front, and that is something where you do land banking and you do want to have parking. Similarly, you know, we're looking long-term at, you know, making the town center more of a walking place for business or whatever, and municipal parking is not at all something that you would not want to have in that case. Beyond that, you know, I think those are the particulars of the purchase itself. Beyond that, there's obviously a dispute here between the property owner and someone who had a right of first refusal. You know, there's allegations going back and forth. I don't think it's appropriate for the town to get into the middle of it. However, I do think that the motion that's before you is appropriate, and that is that, you know, if the town attorney finds that all the papers are satisfactorily completed, you know, it's obvious that the town has given a deposit of 10% of the purchase price of this property. If you didn't honor it, we would be forfeiting that this evening. You know, that was indicated at the last meeting. So I would urge you to approve that motion. Finally, I do want to comment on Mr. Thompson's comment, which I just don't understand, that he says the property isn't worth $35,900, when at the same time, he's here this evening willing to offer $35,900 to the Hennessys. It doesn't pass a straight face test for being so critical of the town overpaying for a piece of property when clearly someone else wants it and is willing to pay that or more. So I just find that difficult. So I would urge the council to move ahead on item number 80 with the clear understanding that all the papers need to be satisfactory to the town attorney.
Councilor McGinty.
Thank you. The issue of the parking lot keeps coming up, and although that was mentioned, and obviously clearly the town manager makes a strong case for that, it's not the only use of that property that's been discussed. We discussed a small park, possibly even a some type of other municipal building on it, perhaps a basketball court, I think, has been mentioned. So I don't think we're strictly looking at it for parking, maybe down the road when the need really is there. But again, it may be, as we said, a good piece of property put in our land bank. Secondly, regarding a public hearing, I believe, and correct me if I'm wrong, that a public hearing was not required on this issue. And in fact, it was at my request so that the public could have input that this was put to a public hearing. And so, you know, I'm sorry that more people didn't know about it and didn't discover it. But the fact is that a public hearing was not required in the first place. So,
thank you, Councillor. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak to this? Councillor Linnell?
Yeah, I have some mixed feelings about this. I'd like to have that property for possibly a new teen center, something like that. But I'm. I have some misgivings about it, and I'm wondering if it's fair to ask. One issue that came up is if we decided for whatever reasons to take it off the tax, taking it off the tax rolls and so forth, and spending the money. I think one issue is. More and more people are getting on the internet. I don't know if they have to go to the library if the demand is there. But anyway, my question is, can we ask if we decided not to purchase the property, if we backed out, so to speak, would Mr. Thompson, I'm wondering if he'd have any interest in reimbursing us our deposit? That's appropriate to ask. I don't know.
You can choose to answer that or not. I would hesitate to have him answer that without advice of legal counsel, quite frankly. We do not have a motion. If we are to proceed with discussion, we need one, Counselor Cogswell.
Ordered, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby authorizes the town manager to execute all required papers necessary for the purchase of the small lot adjacent to the Thomas Memorial Library, provided that all such papers are prepared to the satisfaction of the town attorney. The town council also hereby allocates $35,900 for the acquisition price of the parcel and $2,000 for any incidental expenses that may be incurred. Said funds are to be expended from the Cape Elizabeth Land Acquisition Fund.
I'll second that motion.
Thank you. Further discussion? Counselor Cogswell.
I'd just like to say that we've had several discussions on this issue, and I think we've really analyzed that it is very good planning to purchase this property. It's been recommended in several different studies that have been done by different groups and approved by the town council in the past.
Thank you. Anybody else? Counselor Jordan.
Well, I just want to say I think it's a wise decision to purchase a property, because I think the future it's going to be needed as far as parking and whatever you with more use of the library. And Mrs. Chapman made a good point about the school parking lot, but I ride by there once in a while, and I don't see too many empty ones during the day when school's in session. And it is unhandy for people to walk up around, and they wouldn't use it. They'd be parking in the street beforehand. So I think we should move forward and purchase it.
Thank you. Is there anybody else? All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? Vote is 5-2. Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you for staying this late.
You know, if I have to leave this card.
Is there anything else on here we need to take action on this in this meeting?
Number 83.
Number 83.
I think we can go through the others quickly.
I think we can dispense with the rest of the items fairly quickly. I'd like to try to do so. Item number 79 is receipt of the Town of Cape Elizabeth Technology Plan. Mr. McGovern?
I'd like to recommend that you acknowledge receipt of this and put it off to a workshop.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor? 7. Opposed? 0. Thank you. Item number 81 is acceptance of Cape Woods Drive and related easements. Mr. McGovern?
I would like to recommend you table this item to the October 16th meeting.
Thank you.
I would have made the same recommendation at 10 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 82, a vote upon proposed funding from the Cape Elizabeth Sewer Fund of federally mandated dechlorination facilities at Peebles Cove. Mr. McGovern?
I'd like to suggest you approve this unless there's any counselor who has questions or opposes it. And if there is anyone who either has questions or opposes it, then I'd suggest to be tabled.
Something that's got to be done? Yes.
Yeah, the district otherwise might go out and borrow the money, thus incurring more cost.
Make it more expensive for us.
Can we have a motion, please? Counselor Cogswell.
Ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, what am I doing? I'm sorry. Ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby appropriates $150,000 from the Cape Elizabeth Sewer Fund to permit the Portland Water District to construct federally mandated dechlorination facilities beside Peebles Cove.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? Counselor Reed.
Just a comment for the public. We did review this in workshop.
Yes, we did.
Yes.
Thank Further you. Discussion?
Public and yeah.
All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 83 is vote to set to public hearing on October 16, 1996, on a ballot issue relating to the fluoridation of the public water supply.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 84, action on receipt on a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding the resource protection setbacks. Councilor Jordan?
I'm going to make it short.
Good.
I recommend that we refer it to the Planning Board for a proposed amendment of the zoning laws regarding activities in the resource protection zone buffer. Planning Board is to provide a written comment back to the Town Council no later than February 1st. This is to do with some of the areas that we looked at, especially in Lions Fields, where we could reduce, we would reduce the 250 feet back to 100 feet. And there's a couple other areas, too, in the town.
Thank you very much.
That's my motion.
We have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? All those in favor?
At 12:45, I wasn't going to add any more.
7-0 in favor. Is there any citizen who wishes to discuss an item not on the agenda? Seeing none?
I have one item.
Yes, sir.
I just want to say I see that they've taken Joni Benoit's out of the woods, and they've cut down the bushes, and they're making their new layout.
Thank you.
I just want everyone to take a look.
Thank you.
Looks better now.
I move adjournment.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very, very much.
I want to thank our camera staff, too.
Yes.
Yes.
You have to be at school at what time in the morning?
7:30.
Would you like us to call in for you?
I'm teaching school at 7:30 in the morning.